We are still getting to know each other. So I was thinking about this kind of introductory phase that we're in. And the kind of things I'd like to talk about as we get started in our relationship. And we're going to talk this week and next week about some things that I've already introduced, but we're going to kind of dig deeper in the Sunday nights into those things. Because Sunday night is a really, for me, favorite time of teaching, because I get a longer period of time to do some teaching. I get to be on the floor instead of up there behind that pulpit. And we can be a little bit more casual. We can dig a little bit deeper into some material because of the setting and the format. So on Sunday nights, we will very often spend more time digging a little bit deeper into things, exploring, ranging a little bit more widely. Tonight, we're going to spend a little bit of time looking more deeply into the things we talked about this morning. This morning, we began a series that's going to take us through the month of December, looking at all of the material in the Old Testament story and seeing how it anticipates Jesus. We began with the comment in Matthew 5, verse 17, or Jesus in Matthew's record that we call the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7. Records Jesus saying that he came not to destroy or to abolish the law and the prophets, but to fulfill. It was his statement that expressed his understanding all that material in the Old Testament was about him. And I've mentioned that this morning. I mentioned it. I mentioned the times I've been here before. But we're going to dig a little bit deeper into that idea tonight, showing how the Old Testament provides a foundation leading people to Jesus. And then also moving forward from there into the rest of the New Testament after the Gospels to show how it continues Jesus' teaching activity that we read in the Gospels. And there's a really simple point that we want to focus on tonight. Jesus is the center of the Bible. I can remember when I was growing up, and even for a while when I was in college and in my 20s, and every now and then I hear people say something like, the book of Acts is the hub of the Bible, introduction of the church age, all those kinds of things. And it's wrong. It's just wrong, wrong, wrong. The church can't be the hub of the Bible because there's no church if there's no Jesus. Jesus is the hub of the Bible. Everything revolves around him. That was clearly his understanding in places like Matthew 5, 17. So we're going to dig a little bit deeper into this idea tonight as we explore Jesus' central place in the Bible. And then we'll take a few applications from that material and think about its meaning for our lives. Next Sunday night, we'll look at the New Testament's expectation that just as Jesus is the center of the Bible, so also is he to be the center of our lives. And we'll explore the New Testament's emphasis on being like Jesus, on Christ's likeness. So before we get into the material tonight, let's take a moment and pray together. Father, we're glad that we have a chance to gather as a family tonight, to take time to explore the Bible, to think about all the material that you've put in there, and to think about Jesus' place in our Bibles. Pray that you'll give us insight, that you'll be patient and helpful to us as we consider these things. And we pray as we do this together that you'll help us to grow closer and closer together through your Son, so that we can more faithfully represent you and the communities around us. And we ask this through Jesus. Amen. Now, one other thing that I do, I'm not sure how many of you are aware of this yet or not, but I have handouts. I always have handouts for things I do because I realize sometimes people get distracted. They don't follow along for all kinds of reasons. So handouts, you can grab them, you can follow along, you can take it home, throw it away, do whatever you want with a handout that I make available. But they're there if you want them. Okay. As we read through the Gospels, we find Jesus making all kinds of claims. In fact, if you read through the Gospels, you find that Jesus very often incensed the people around him because of the claims that he made. Sometimes it was because of their misunderstandings. Very often it was because he intentionally made claims in ways that provoked the people around him. Jesus was always making bold claims about his, for example, ability to forgive sins. Making bold claims, for example, about his relationship with God. But also making bold claims about his relationship to the Bible. Now, if we remember, Jesus, when he was in his ministry, there was no New Testament, just Old Testament. So whenever he's talking about scriptures, the law and the prophets, the various ways he talked about the Bible. For him and for his audience, that would have meant the material in the Old Testament. That was their Bible. And Jesus made a lot of pretty startling claims about his relationship to the material in the Old Testament. We're going to look at just a few passages to explore Jesus' claims about his relationship to the material in the Old Testament. And we've already looked at the one in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 17. We talked about that a little bit this morning, where in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus claimed that he came to fulfill the law and the prophets. And it's not just, I came to do all the stuff that God tells people to do, but it's much more profound, much more radical statement. What he was claiming was that all that material that you have in your Bible from Genesis to Malachi, it's all about me. I'm the end of that storyline. I'm the conclusion to that narrative. It's a really surprising, and from the perspective of an outsider, like, for example, when I came and tried out in September, if I got in the pulpit and said, I am the goal of all the material in the Bible, I'm the conclusion of that narrative, you'd have said, what an arrogant, pompous person. We will never hire this individual. So put yourself in the place of the people who were in Jesus' world. For them to hear Jesus claim an uneducated, wandering, homeless teacher to be the goal, the summary, the purpose of the Old Testament material is a pretty startling claim. But he made other claims as well. We have in Luke chapter 4. In Luke chapter 4, beginning in verse 16 down through verse 21, Jesus, in Luke's account, the beginning of Jesus' ministry. And he goes to his hometown, Nazareth. Goes to the synagogue, and he's there with the people that he's grown up with. In Jesus' world, people didn't really move a whole lot unless there was war, unless there was famine, or unless there was some really dramatic event to force them out of their homeland. People tended to be fairly stable, staying in the same place. So he shows up at the place where he'd grown up. He's with people that know him. And he goes to the synagogue on the Sabbath, and he's teaching. And he reads from the Isaiah scroll in Luke chapter 4. In beginning of verse 18, this is what he reads. He reads from a section in Isaiah 61, beginning of verse 1. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Now, this passage is a really important passage in Isaiah. It's part of that focus that occupies the last half of the book of Isaiah, beginning chapter 40 through chapter 66. Where Isaiah looks forward to God's promises of future redemption from captivity and restoration of the nation. Isaiah was writing before the beginning of the Babylon captivity. And his message to the Jews before that event was, there's going to be some really difficult times coming because God is sending you into a really severe captivity because of your long-standing rebelliousness. But then he also says, but there's going to be coming a time after that when God's going to release you. He's going to restore you to your land. He's going to restore your blessings. He's going to restore his relationship to you. Really big promises. And Jesus reads that section from Isaiah 61, verse 1, verse 2. And for his audience, they were still waiting for the fulfillment of those things. They're captive to Rome. It's no longer Babylon, but from Babylon they passed to Persia, they passed to the Greeks, they passed eventually to Rome. And they were still waiting for that promise of redemption and restoration. And after reading that passage, that would have been in the minds of all of Jesus' audience, because it was the thing the Jewish people were waiting for, Jesus rolls up the scroll, gives it back to the attendant, and he sits down. And everybody's looking at him. And then he says, in verse 21, today the scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. I'm what God was talking about in Isaiah 61, 1 and 2. I am the restoration. I'm the redemption. I'm all that stuff you've been waiting for. It was a really shocking claim because Rome remained in control. They remained two, not 12 tribes. They remained a dispersed people, not a united, restored people like they had been under David and Solomon. We have another passage, John chapter 5, verse 39 and verse 40. This is the one that was read for us just a moment ago. And in this section, in John 5, Jesus has just performed a miracle. Chapter 5 begins with Jesus healing a man at the pool of Bethesda in the city of Jerusalem. And this attracts people's attention because it's a miracle. And it causes some controversy because there is in Jesus' healings an implicit authority. He's making authority claim. And the religious leaders, the scribes, the Pharisees, have issue with Jesus' claims of authority because he's not acting like someone they think who claims to have authority ought to act. He's working on the Sabbath. He's hanging out with disreputable people. He's doing the kind of things that they looked at as indications that he's not somebody who's an authoritative figure. And so this leads to a conversation in John chapter 5 where Jesus is talking about his authority beginning in verse 19. And then beginning in verse 30, he talks about some witnesses to the authority that he claims. He says, John the Baptist is proof that I have authority. Because of his ministry, the things that he was teaching that you paid attention to. Then he also says the miracles that I'm performing are evidences of my authority. But then Jesus turns to the audience, and that gets us to verse 39 and verse 40. And he says to the audience, you're not paying attention to those things. You don't accept those witnesses to my authority. In fact, he says, you spend your time in the scriptures, and you don't even understand the scriptures that you spend time in. Because these are they that speak about me, and you've rejected me. I'm the one the scriptures are all about. And you've missed that because you don't understand your scriptures. It's a really confrontational claim that he makes there. Another passage, this one at the end of Luke, Luke 24. Luke 24, beginning verse 44. Now, at this point in Luke's narrative, Jesus has been crucified, he has been resurrected, and he's been with the disciples, and we are right before his ascension. Luke wrote both the Gospel of Luke and the book of Acts. It's one long narrative divided into two sections. And the end of Luke leads us into the beginning of Acts. So we are after his death and his resurrection, right before his ascension. And he's been with his disciples now for 3 years. 3 years they have been benefiting from his teaching. 3 years he's been talking to them. 3 years he's been explaining to them, giving them teachings that he wasn't giving to everyone else. 3 years. And you think in 3 years with Jesus, they would have connected a lot of the dots together. You'd think in 3 years with Jesus, they would see the big picture that Jesus was constantly talking about. But notice, as Jesus is talking with the disciples there in this section, Luke 24, beginning verse 44, he said to them, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. But notice the next part. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. That's really important. Their minds were not opened. They hadn't fully understood or accepted Jesus' place in relationship to the material in the Old Testament. There were still levels at which they were either misunderstanding or rejecting his claim about authority of the Old Testament. And it took him opening their minds to cause them to understand that. And we have one more. This one is in Galatians 3. This is not Jesus talking about his relationship, but this is Paul reflecting on Jesus' relationship to the material in the Old Testament. And as we talked this morning about Galatians chapter 3, we commented on Paul's discussion about the promise that God made to Abraham in Genesis 12. Then he picks it up again and quotes from the reiteration of that promise in Genesis 22 and verse 18. And it's in the section which he's talking about the purpose of the law of Moses. Why did God give the law of Moses if his plan was always going to move through the promise to Abraham, which predates the law of Moses by some 430 years. And as he's talking about the purpose of the law, he discusses the purpose of the law of Moses in a Jesus-centric way. Notice the comments that he makes in Galatians chapter 3 and verse 24. We talked about this this section this morning. But he comments here that the law, and when he says the law, he's talking about the law of Moses, all the material God had given to the Israelites through Moses. The law was our guardian until Christ came. And I'm reading from the English Standard Version, but I prefer the way the New American Standard Version puts it here. In the New American Standard, it talks about how the law was our tutor to lead us to Christ. It was his understanding that material in the Old Testament was designed by God to lead people to Jesus. But it's not just the relationship that Jesus had with the Old Testament that was startling. We find additionally that Jesus made claims about his relationship to the material that would eventually form what we call the New Testament. Now, at the time, he's talking about these things with the disciples. They didn't understand where that would lead. But he talked to them, particularly in the latter part of John's Gospel, chapter 14, chapter 16. We'll read a few passages in just a minute. About the things that he would continue to do with the apostles following his death. Look in John's Gospel, John chapter 14. That's where we'll start. John 14 is part of the section where Jesus is with his disciples in private right before his betrayal. Beginning in chapter 13, 14, 15, 16, he's with the disciples giving them teaching in the leading up to his betrayal. And in the section, there's lots of tension, misunderstanding, frustration from the disciples. Things are really tense between Jesus and the religious establishment, and they know it. Everybody knows it. It's obvious at this point that people are trying to kill him. They know it. Everyone knows it. But they hadn't put everything together yet. There was really clear frustration and worry and fear on the disciples' part. And that leads to this comment that Jesus makes to them in John chapter 14, verse 18. He says, "I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you." Now, very shortly from this time, he's going to be killed. Now, he would be resurrected 3 days after his death, but then he would only be around sporadically for 40 days, and then he's gone and he's not been back since. That hardly qualifies, I would think, if I was in the disciples' position, to not being an orphan. It would seem like orphan, not an orphan, orphaned again. But he goes on to explain what he means by, "I'm not going to leave you as orphans. I'm not going to abandon you. I'm going to stay with you." Notice, so we drop down a little bit in John chapter 14, verses 25 and 26. He says, "These things I've spoken to you while I'm still with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things." And notice what he says next: "Bring to your remembrance all that I've said to you." The Holy Spirit would continue as an representative of Jesus in the lives of the apostles, bringing actively, miraculously, through the agency of the things that the Holy Spirit has control over, memories of Jesus' teachings in time with the disciples to the disciples. But it was more than just being a source of remembrance for the disciples of the time of Jesus. It was more than that. Jump ahead to chapter 16. John 16, beginning verse 12. Jesus, a little bit later, in the same conversation he's having with the disciples, makes this comment. He says, "I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now." A lot more teaching that he understood the disciples needed, but that they weren't ready for yet. He says, "A lot more that I have to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak of his own authority, but whatever he hears, he'll speak, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you." Jesus says, "I'm not going to abandon you. The Holy Spirit will remind you of all the things that I have taught you, and he will continue to bring to you my ongoing teachings. I'm going to continue to have an active teaching, guiding, leading role in your lives through the Holy Spirit's presence inside of you." This is a promise that Jesus made to his disciples. Now, as we move forward from here, we'll go to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And we begin to see how this connects to the material that we have in our New Testaments. In 1 Corinthians 2, Paul is writing to the church in the city of Corinth. And there was all kinds of division among the Christians in Corinth because of different ideas about the nature of Christianity and distinction and honor and all different kinds of things. And so in addressing a divided people, Paul talks to them about his message and the difference between his message and the messages from all those different people that was leading to the division that they were experiencing. And as he's talking about his message, that leads him to talk about God giving him the message that he was delivering. And that leads to a conversation where he talks about the role of the Holy Spirit that Jesus promised in John 14 and John 16. He comments in beginning verse 6 of 1 Corinthians chapter 2, how they have been given wisdom, a secret wisdom that God has revealed to them. And as he talks about this wisdom that God has given to him and the other writers of the New Testament, he says in verse 10, "These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit, for the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For who knows a person's thoughts except the spirit of that person which is in him? So no one comprehends the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God." And he talks about how the Spirit is taking the deep things of God's mind and revealing it to himself and the other writers of the New Testament. helping them take those spiritual things of God and pair them with spiritual words which they wrote down. So in this section, he's talking about how through the Holy Spirit, he and the other writers are helping people know the mind of God. But notice how he concludes this section, the end of chapter 2, verse 16. Who has understood the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? Now remember, up to this point, he's been talking about God. But notice how he ends. But we have the mind of Christ. This is a really important point that he makes. In revealing the things that God was giving them through the Holy Spirit, they were receiving the mind of Christ, which is the same thing as the mind of God. What Paul and the other writers of the New Testament were putting down that we have that forms the New Testament are those ongoing teachings that Jesus promised to the apostles in John 14 and John 16. So all of our New Testament is the authoritative teachings of Jesus that he's given to those who follow him, those who claim to be his disciples, those who believe in him. Now, as we think about those claims that Jesus made, that everything in the Old Testament revolves around him and everything in the New Testament comes from him, we want to think a little bit more deeply about how those materials accomplish those purposes, especially with the Old Testament, because it's easy to say, oh, yeah, yeah, the Old Testament's about Jesus. But if you've ever read through the Old Testament, it seems like a stretch sometimes to say that material's about Jesus because so much of it seems disconnected from the Jesus we read about in the New Testament. In fact, that's why very often in my experiences, I've encountered people who, when they talk about the Old Testament, they talk about it as being different from Jesus. Well, you know, there's the God in the Old Testament, then there's Jesus in the New Testament. And they present it as if they are two disconnected parts of the Bible. And there's the implication of, thank God we live in the New Testament, not the Old Testament, because man, they had it rough back then. But Jesus' comment was that there's continuity. Everything in the Old Testament's about him. Everything in the New Testament comes from him. Everything is continuous. Everything revolves around him. So how then does the material in the Old Testament revolve around Jesus? How does it prepare people for him? In just a brief way, we want to sketch out some of these things as we think about Jesus' claims about his relationship to the material in the Old Testament. And as we mentioned this morning, we have a context for the material in the Old Testament. It begins with God's plan for humanity to be in a distinct, special relationship with him, a relationship against which they rebelled, which led to the promise issued in Genesis 12 that God would restore humanity's relationship with him. But part of that rebellion that we're introduced to in Genesis 3 through Genesis 11 involved, as a corollary, people losing their understanding of God's identity. For example, Hosea talks about this, chapter 4, verse 1 down through verse 3, as he talks about God's divorce case against the Israelites. And the reason he says that God is bringing a case against the inhabitants of the land is because there's no knowledge of God in the land. Now, Hosea is talking to Jewish people who had the law of Moses, who had the temple, who were observant for the temple or observant of the temple, worship schedules and activities. They had an active priesthood. They had all that stuff. But it hadn't resulted in the relationship with God that God intended. So God says, you don't know me, even though you do a lot of stuff that revolves around me. There's no relationship there. So in the Old Testament, we have God revealing himself to the people of the world through the things that he's recorded as doing. For example, we see this very clearly in the book of Exodus. In Exodus chapter 6, God has sent Moses back to Egypt with this announcement that God has chosen him to bring the Israelites out of their slavery in the land of Egypt. And part of this announcement is God's expressed purpose for the rescue that he's promised through Moses. In Exodus chapter 6, as he's talking to Moses about his plan for him, he says that he's going to do it in ways, in verse 7, that would cause the Israelites to know that he is the Lord their God. All the stuff that I'm going to do through you, Moses, I'm doing for this very specific purpose, to prove to the Israelites who I am. But it wasn't just the Israelites. Jump ahead to chapter 7. Chapter 7 and verse 5. It was also for the Egyptians' sake, so that the Egyptians would know the sovereign, unique identity of God. But it wasn't just for the Israelites. It wasn't just for the Egyptians. Chapter 9. In chapter 9, God, as he's talking through Moses about his plans for the seventh plague, beginning verse 13, says that he's going to unleash his plagues with full force at this point so that not only Pharaoh, but all the nations of the earth would understand the unique sovereign identity of God. God was working in ways that would reveal himself in his uniqueness and his sovereignty to the world through the Exodus events. And this reaches its pinnacle at the end of Exodus, Exodus 34, verses 5, 6, and 7, where God announces his character to Moses. I am the Lord your God. And he lists a whole series of things that define him: merciful, gracious, compassionate, faithful, loving, kind, etc., etc., etc. That's the character of God that God reveals in the Old Testament to people who'd forgotten who he was because they're wrapped up in their sins. So part of the way that the Old Testament prepares people for Jesus is by revealing the character of God, who is the same person that we see in Jesus in the New Testament. So when we are reading about Jesus in the New Testament, there ought to be within us recognition of the God who revealed himself in the Old Testament. So as Jesus is going about teaching and doing, we're saying, that's just like the God I've been reading about in the Old Testament. Those values, those agendas, those goals are the same that characterize God in the Old Testament. But we also find in the Old Testament, there is an unmasking of sin and the crisis that it creates that prepares people to appreciate the redemption that God offers to them through Jesus. This is part of Paul's comments in Galatians chapter 3. And we mentioned already a little bit from Galatians chapter 3, but listen to a couple of other comments that Paul makes in the section in Galatians chapter 3. He's talked about how Jesus is the goal of the material in the Old Testament. He's the fulfillment of the promise, but he makes a couple connections between the law of Moses and its relationship to Jesus. He's already commented, as we mentioned in verse 24, that its purpose, the law of Moses' purpose, was to lead people to Jesus. But there's a couple other things that it does that are in support of leading people to Jesus. Notice in verse 19, and he asks very clearly, why did God give the law then? If his plan was always to accomplish his purpose through the promise to Abraham, why bother with the law that comes 430 years after the promise? And he's very clear. Its purpose was to define sin. It was added because of transgressions or for the sake of defining sin. It had as part of its intention, its design, features that would impress upon people the reality of their sin and their need for someone to save them from that situation. Because they're unable, in the most profound, absolute sense, they're unable to extricate themselves from that sin problem. But in addition to that, we find that there's this revelation of sin and its problem that it presents for humanity. But at the same time, going along with that, there's this gradual unfolding of the promise that we're introduced to in Genesis 12 with Abraham. We talked about this morning that we're going to walk our way through this month, and the Sunday mornings is in this month of December. In the Old Testament, there's this gradual unfolding of what exactly God had in mind when he promised to bless all the families of the earth through Abraham and his family. So that when we arrive at Jesus and Jesus says, yes, I'm the one, I am the fulfillment of those things, there ought to be within readers of the Bible, of course, I see the connection. I see how he is that person bringing into fulfillment all of the things that God is doing in the material in the Old Testament. And then as we move into the New Testament, we find that it continues that focus on Jesus as we find the writers being guided by the Holy Spirit to reveal Jesus' ongoing teachings for those people who follow him, for those people that comprise the church, the things that Jesus believed they need to know. As we find, for example, John 14, John 16, 1 Corinthians 2 that we've already talked about. But it's more than just giving teachings. We find in the New Testament the writers applying the record of Jesus' life and teachings in the gospel to the daily life of Christians. So this is what Jesus did. This is what it means for your life in the world. Jesus taught these things. Jesus did these things. These things define his values, his agendas. And this is what it looks like for you, those people that make up his church, those who have willingly submitted to his authority. This is what it means for your life, for your thinking, for your relationships. It maps out for them the application of Jesus to the lives of his people in the world. But it also helps impress upon them the reality of Jesus' sovereign lordship. That's part of what we see in the book of Acts. It's not the church is growing and doing things. Rather, it's Jesus is in control. And because he's in control, the church thrives in a world hostile to it. It's evidence that he really is the one who's seated above all authority, all powers, all principalities, as he announces at the end of Matthew's gospel, Matthew chapter 28, as Paul writes at the end of Ephesians chapter 1. It's evidence that he is sovereign in the same way that God announced his sovereignty in Exodus. And just like in Exodus, as God is calling his people out of their slavery in Egypt, so too is Jesus calling his people out of slavery to the world in a new Exodus. Jesus is at the heart of the Bible, and he brings to all those narratives in the Bible continuity, consistency, and significance, so that as we see his place, we begin to see all the different ways in which the Bible story folds in on itself and provides for us deep, meaningful, connected teachings that are to transform us in our lives. Now, let's think about a few applications from this. Because remember, again, the point of the Bible is not to be a really tightly, intelligently written theological literary work. Its purpose is practical. Its purpose is transformative. So what kind of things can we take from this as we think about Jesus and his central place within the Bible? First, I think it's important when we think about the Bible as a Jesus-centric book, it should remind us that he is to be the filter for the way we read and interpret its materials. I've been unpacking the books, the boxes of books in my office. And if you were to go in there right now, it's just a travesty. It really hurts me. There's no order. They're all stuffed in places. But at the same time, I'm kind of excited. I was talking to somebody about this. It's, for me, an opportunity to rethink my order of the books on my shelves, which is kind of a nerdy pleasure for me. But as I'm working through there, I have lots of books that are about hermeneutics, which is a fancy word for thinking about how we think and study the Bible. Jesus is the only thing we need to think about how to read and interpret the Bible. Now, there's more to it than that. I understand there's more to it than that. I'm not naive. But Jesus is the filter. Jesus is the interpretive center. He's the capstone without which nothing else can stand up, nothing else can make sense. If we want to learn how to read and study the Bible, we should begin by saying, how did Jesus read and study and interpret the Bible? If we want to understand how to apply the Bible, we should begin by saying, how did Jesus apply the Bible? And beginning from there, try and do in our study, in our teaching, in our application, things that mirror what he himself was doing. That's the first and most important thing. But as we think about Jesus' central place in the Bible and how he's to be our filter for reading and understanding it, there are, I think, some additional points that come out of that. And the first one, because Jesus is at the center of the Bible, because it's a Jesus-centered book, that means then its focus is on the person of Jesus and not merely the text of the Bible. And that's a really important point. We are not Christians because we have Bibles. We're Christians because of Jesus, who has given us the Bible that talks about him. I've heard people say, oh, New Testament Christians, New Testament Christians, which is true. I appreciate that. But I am a Jesus Christian first. And because I follow Jesus, then I'm somebody devoted to the New Testament because it is his teachings authoritatively given through the Holy Spirit to the people who wrote those things. But if we put text first, we have a problem. We have done that old saying, cart before the horse. It has to be the other way around always. When we think about Jesus' place in the Bible, then we're reminded that the Bible is a book that focuses on the person of Jesus more than the text. And that's what Jesus was talking about in John chapter 5, verses 39 and 40, that passage that was read for us by the young man a little while ago. He's talking to his audience. He says, you search the scriptures. And they did it passionately. They knew their scriptures in ways that would shame many of us. But even though they knew a lot about the Bible, they didn't understand the Bible because it was knowledge divorced from the person of Jesus. Knowledge separated from the person of God. Information without relationship. And it's really important as we study and as we think about our Bibles that we understand its focus is on the person of Jesus. And that means then, secondly, its emphasis is on character more than rules. Now, certainly, the Bible has lots of rules. Some people have counted up different numbering systems for the rules in the Old Testament. And the generally agreed upon number, 636, I believe, rules in the Old Testament. That's a lot of rules. But the Bible's emphasis is not on rules, even though rules are there and they're important and we're expected to understand them and follow them. The emphasis is on character. The purpose of the rules is to transform us into a particular character, a kind of person. A person whose character reflects the character of God as revealed in the Bible and most especially in the person of Jesus. The Bible's agenda is to change us, to transform us, to remake us into different people. And as we spend time in our Bibles then, we are to focus on the expectations of character. For example, Matthew chapter 23 and verse 23. Jesus is in a section in which he's condemning the scribes and the Pharisees. In Matthew's gospel, up to this point, there has been a deeply contentious and increasingly contentious relationship between Jesus and the religious leaders, the scribes and the Pharisees. And it reached a boiling point, a tipping point in Matthew chapter 23. After in Matthew's gospel, a series of situations where they were testing Jesus, trying to trap him, to publicly shame him, Jesus turns to the crowds of people around him and says, I'm going to tell you who these people are. Woe to you, scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites. He begins a prophetic denouncement of the scribes and the Pharisees, like we have in Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel, of the people to whom they were writing. And we get to verse 23 in Matthew chapter 23. And he says, woe to you, scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites, because you tithe mint, dill, and cumin. And he says, you should do those things. You rightly do those things. They were observing the laws. But he said, here's the problem. You have neglected the weightier provisions of the law, justice, mercy, and faithfulness. Those are character matters. Character matters that reflect the character of God. Because God is just, because God is merciful, because God is faithful, we should be those things. And any amount of tithing and sacrificing and worshiping that's disconnected from the character of God is offensive to God. It makes a mockery of his identity. Because it assumes merely going through motions is all that he wants. But he wants something more than that. He wants character. And as we think about Jesus' central place in the Bible, we're reminded that its emphasis on his person extends to its emphasis on character and not merely rules. And then thirdly, as we think about Jesus' central place in the Bible, we are reminded that the goal of the Bible is a relationship. Jesus is the center. It's about his person. It focuses on character that mirrors his character. And the purpose of all that is relationship. Go all the way back to Genesis 1, Genesis 2. We find there the picture of God's intention for humanity. Why did he make us? Because, as John clarifies in 1 John 4, he is a God who is loving. He is love. He made humanity to be in a loving relationship with him. And the goal of the Bible is to restore humanity to that goal, to that purpose. And Jesus, as the center of the Bible, is the one around whom we come to understand both that goal and the one through whom we can regain our place in that goal. Jesus' place within our lives ought to result in our growing relationship with God that transforms us into better people, more faithful people, more kind people, more loving people, more gracious people. People who are transformed into increasingly God-like character because we see God in the person of Jesus and we're transformed by him through his place in the Bible, his teachings in the New Testament. That's the Bible that we're going to talk about from here on out. That's what we're going to spend all of our time talking about. So I have just now told you everything I'm going to talk about for as long as I'm with you all. from this point forward, everything is repetition. We'll get deeper, but if you think about everything in the Bible, is the same development of this message. And the need for God to constantly come back to that message ought to tell us something. We're thick-headed, stubborn people who struggle to accept what God says is true about himself and about us. Now, we're here on a Sunday night because we believe those things. But merely believing those things doesn't always mean we follow through as we should with those things. And part of God's wisdom is that as we gather together and we profess our shared conviction about these things, we also are reminded about the accountabilities we have before God through the shared accountability we have in our relationships with one another. So tonight, I want to encourage you, if you have a need in your life for the prayers of your church family, if you have a need in your life for the help of God, if you have a need in your life for the things that God promises to do for us through Jesus, redemption, forgiveness, restoration to your relationship with him through baptism, belonging to his church, and transformation, this is a chance to announce those needs. If you have things in your life for which you're thankful and you want to express your joy to God, this is a chance to do that before the church family. Whatever your need might be, you have a chance right now to come forward and let it be known as we stand and sing.